Shalom, Rastafari, greetings to Alana, Sananta, Taina, Yistalim. This is actually concerning a Rastafari Sendbet study or Shabbat study. Number 13, Shemot. Now, we're going to do like a brief summary, but not of the complete Torah reading or Ori Nebab, but rather a summary of those themes concerning Ethiopia, you know, via Zipporah. Now, keep in mind that it is the glory of the Almighty to conceal a thing and the honor of kings to seek out a matter. You know, Jah would not allow for those things concealed which are his glory. He would not allow them to be, you know, revealed to them who are not honorable in seeking out the matter with a pure heart, you know. And so, keep that in mind. Now, going forth, that's actually kind of like a hint to the Kevra Negesht, the glory of kings, the honor of kings, you know. So, seek out a matter with a pure heart, we would say. So now, there's something going on within, between the lines, we would say, concerning Ethiopia. We're not going to go forward with presenting like much of what we have learned concerning the matter, but there is something taking place within. It seems as if it begins in Exodus, but there's something taking place that is very, very like very well embedded within Scripture, but not too clear, and so something that's not clearly being shown, but still Scripture clearly indicates its presence. And so it all has to do with Ethiopia. And so we, you know, I fully Jah willing, as the Sendbet studies go, you know, take their natural progression, we hope to kind of bring this to light. So now we're going to begin with the book of Exodus chapter 2 verse 21. It seems like this is where it all begins, and so it reads, "And Moses was content to dwell with a man, this man whom is also referred to as Reuel, Jethro, the Midian priest, here referred to as the man. So Moses content to dwell with the man, and he gave Moses Zipporah, his daughter. And she bare him a son, and he called his name Gershon, for he said, I have been a stranger in a strange land." And so, you know, to kind of like connect this with Ethiopia, Zipporah, and connect her with Ethiopia, we got to go forward to the book of Numbers, chapter 12, and Scripture will kind of reveal to us some matters or some details concerning Zipporah, the daughter of the Midian priest, the daughter of the man, the daughter of Reuel, the daughter of Reguel, the daughter of Jethro. And so, the book of Numbers, chapter 12, it's going to be verse 1. It reads, "And Miriam and Aaron spake against Moses, because of the Ethiopian woman whom he had married, for he had married an Ethiopian woman." And so now Scripture clearly reveals the fact that Zipporah, the daughter of the man, Jethro, Reuel, the Midian priest, is in fact Ethiopian. And so we're actually going to go forward to the book of Exodus chapter 4. And this is where you know, things start kind of coming together. Although they're not all that well clear, they're very clearly embedded within the Scripture, you know, if that kind of makes any sense. So going forward, okay, chapter 4, and we'll begin with verse 23, chapter 4, verse 23, and this is the return of Moses to Egypt, and it reads, and I say to thee, let my son go, that he may serve me, And if thou refuse to let him go, behold, I will slay thy son, even thy firstborn. Now verse 24, and it came to pass by the way in the end, that the Lord met him and sought to kill him. Thence Zipporah took a sharp stone and cut off the foreskin of her son, and cast it at his feet, and said, surely a bloody husband art thou to me. So he let him go. Then she said, a bloody husband thou art because of the circumcision. We'll conclude with verse 27, and it reads, and the Lord said to Aaron, go into the wilderness to meet Moses. And he went and met him in the mount of God and kissed him. So another detail concerning this is Psalm 72 verse 9, the hidden name of Ethiopia. King James Version wrote in, or you know, added wilderness when both the 1909 Reina Valera Spanish version and the Metzhaf Eduz, the Book of the Seven Seals, when they both clearly agree that Psalm 72 verse 9 actually correctly, it should read, Ethiopia shall bow or prostrate before him, and his enemies shall lick the dust and stuff like that. And so, we mentioned that because Aaron is instructed to go into the wilderness. So could it be Ethiopia? Perhaps, maybe. We're not affirming that, but the possibility does exist, and there is a very big probability that is in fact the case. So now, we're reading from the Old Schofield Study Bible, and so we have a footnote concerning that whole scenario. And so it reads, the context interprets verse 24, Moses was forgetful of the very foundation sign of Israel's covenant relation to Yahweh. On the eve of delivering Israel, he was thus reminded that without circumcision, an Israelite was cut off from the covenant. So, interesting. Moses is forgetful concerning pretty much like the very foundation sign of Israel's covenant. And who was it that kind of saved the day? Zipporah. Now, the question, or kind of the thought that we bring forth, and you know, Jah willing, implanted along the brains of those that are really interested in learning like the fullness of truth, we just bring forth the fact that it was Zipporah that made up for that which was lacking in Moses, you know, remembering the basic foundational sign of Israel's covenant, the circumcision. So we ask ourselves, how is it that Zipporah, if not learnt in Israel's covenant prior to this, how is it that she was quick to take a stone and cut off the foreskin of her son? You know, saving Moses in this case from it says here that the Lord met him and sought to kill him. You know, Zipporah basically saved Moses from him being slayed by the Lord himself, you know. So it has to be that Zipporah was already learnt in those things which Moses showed himself to be forgetful of. And, you know, to further, you know, kind of like bring life or light to this obvious fact, but not too obvious, is that when the Almighty appeared to, when the angel of the Almighty appeared to Moses, that whole scene with the burning bush, Moses was taking care of Jethro's flock. So we're not going to get too deep into that, but keep in mind that Jethro's flock heard and listened to everything that was told Moses from the fiery bush. You know, and we'll give like an extra note Acts chapter 7, if we're not mistaken, somewhere along from verse 20. Actually, the whole chapter, Acts of the Apostles, chapter 7. There is leading towards the end, there is a statement concerning the wilderness and how certain individuals do always refuse the Spirit. Now, Zipporah also is defined in the Hebrew as a bird, kind of, you know. So, you know, just putting that forth, the whole, you know, it could be it relates to the dove and the Spirit and stuff like that. But definitely check out Acts of the Apostles, chapter 7. And actually, it also makes mention of the house. But Solomon built an house, howbeit the Most High dwelleth not in temples made with hands, as saith the prophet. You know, and so, you know, just bringing that forth, so that, okay, it's verse 44, it reads, our fathers had the tabernacle of witness in the wilderness, as he had appointed, speaking to Moses that he should make it according to the fashion that he had seen. So, actually, this, we give thanks to the Almighty. This brings to mind that this is indicating that there was already a tabernacle. Moses set up another tabernacle according to the manner of which he had seen from the first tabernacle. So there was an example. Then, only then, Moses went forth and raised another tabernacle. So there's obviously something here. Ethiopia has everything to do with it. For us that have accepted, you know, the plain and obvious truth of Rastafari, we kind of know what this is heading towards or where this is taking us. But to others, you know, we ask that if ones are true to thyself, then seek out truth. You know, we'll conclude with one last comment, and this is concerning Exodus chapter 2, verse 16. We here bring forth the thought, the meditation. Is the marriage of Moses with Zipporah, the Ethiopian, a foreshadowing of the marriage between King Solomon of Jerusalem with Queen Makeda of Sheba of Ethiopia? And here is our support, scriptural support to that thought. Book of Exodus, chapter 2, verse 16 reads, now the priest of Midian had 7 daughters, and they came and drew water, and filled the troughs to water their father's flock. So, Zipporah, you know, in a sense, can be, and we accept to be, the queen of the 7. There were Jethro, or in this case it reads, the priest of Midian had 7 daughters, Sheba, 7, Seba. And so, the reason we title her queen is because she takes the hand of Moses, a prince coming out of Egypt. And so is this a foreshadowing of Solomon and Sheba, Makeda of Ethiopia? It clearly is, you know. In this case, Zipporah now becomes a type of queen of Sheba. Out of her 7 daughters, most likely, due to custom and tradition, she was the eldest, the queen, and took the hand of a prince coming out of Egypt. And now, which actually reminds us, and will bring forth another kind of like connection, a link. Princes shall come out of Egypt, Ethiopia shall soon stretch forth her hands to God. Was not Moses, kind of like a given God's status over Pharaoh? Indeed, scripture, the book of Exodus, goes into that. So Moses was to be like a god to Pharaoh. So, in a sense, in a type, Zipporah stretching forth her hands to the Almighty, you know, in that sense. Or even in the bush, you know, the flock of Jethro was present, and we're not sure if Zipporah was present, but nonetheless, scripture does indicate that Zipporah was well learned. Actually, either she had a better memory or was better learned concerning the Israel covenant. Relative to Moses. And so, you know, with that, it's pretty much all we had to say. But yeah, keep this in mind. There's something going on. There was already a certain church with Moses when he received some instructions and some words, and Israel had not yet received the same, you know. So we'll conclude with that. Shalom, Rastafari.